Okay, it's not a big deal. We have come, sometimes we have technical difficulties, and God bless all the wires that are going out, all the messages that are going out right now, Palm Sunday, all the ways that the United States churches are being able to talk to people through the internet. I just thank God for this. Could you imagine a time where we wouldn't have been able to talk to you face to face? And I just want to bless that today. I want to pray, God, that you would bless it, that you would bless all the words that are going out, God, and that you would make the ears open and that America would awaken in this time. Speaking in Jesus' name, amen. Speaking of Palm Sunday, you know, next week is Easter, but Palm Sunday is the day that they made Jesus, they declared Jesus King. And I feel like that's what I want to talk about this morning, that we would declare Jesus as King. We're in a new world. We are not in the old world. COVID-19 has put us all in a different place. And I want to talk about that this morning a little bit. But I feel like what the ultimate result is that the earth would declare Jesus as King. He would be made King. I believe that's what he's after. He's after something from us. And I feel like he wants us to learn honor in this hour where we're silent. I think he wants us to be silent. I think he wants us to awaken. I think he wants us to learn honor. He wants us to learn to honor him. He wants us to learn to honor our families. He wants us to learn to honor the blessed nation that we've been given and not in a place of complaining all the time. But you want to, you also want to remember that we're coming out of a fast. I know some of you are just coming on. Good morning. Welcome to Hope City Live Church, Facebook Live. You know, we are coming out of the fast. This week will be the end of the fast, and we're going to go into Easter, and we are expecting something. You know, God rides above the heavens, and he listens for our prayers. He rides to and fro. You just feel him and hear him, and he's riding to catch those prayers, and he wants us to learn to pray. He wants this to be an hour where we would learn how to pray effectively, intelligent prayers. I feel like that's one of the things that we have to do better. Night and day prayer is the vehicle that God rides on. And he rides on those prayers and he answers them. And if you want answers in your life right now, you're sitting in your house. You have nothing to do but go to Home Depot. You have nowhere else to go. Maybe some of you are sneaking out and going up to Quick Trip. I don't know. Most of us are doing what we're supposed to be doing, and we're just kind of sitting still. Some of us are thinking it's not a big deal. I want to say hi to some of the doctors and nurses that I know that are going to watch this later. I know that there's a few of you that are radiologists that are going to be watching this later. I just want to say hi and thank you for putting yourself in risk. I want to say to those that are still out there taking care of the city and the nation in different stores, I want to say thank you to you for putting yourself on the line. But for so many people, we are in a matter of silence. That's where we're at. We're in a place of silence. And what is God after when we are silent? So much noise, so much clutter. I want to tell you what I believe. I believe that COVID-19 is judgment. I believe that with all my heart. You're not going to convince me of anything else. I believe that it's judgment on the land. I believe there's a lot of people who don't like to hear that. I think that there's a lot of people, excuse me, who think that judgment is a harsh word to use. Well, I want to tell you, I want to read you Jeremiah 23. It says, "For who has stood in the counsel of the Lord and has perceived and heard his word? Who has marked his word and heard it? It says, behold, a whirlwind of the Lord has gone forth in fury. A violent whirlwind, and it will fall violently on the head of the wicked. The anger of the Lord will not turn back until he has executed and performed the thoughts of his heart." You know, he has some thoughts on his heart. And in the silence, what do? We're asking him, "What are your thoughts, God? What are you thinking right now? What are you trying to get at? What is it that you're after in my life?" It says he won't turn back, you guys, until he has performed the thoughts of his heart completely. And it says, in the latter days, when Jeremiah wrote this, he said, in the latter way out in time, he said, you'll understand what I'm saying perfectly. It starts out by saying, who has stood in the counsel of the Lord? I believe there's a window of opportunity. I know we're in a crisis, but I also believe that we're in a window of opportunity that the church would take it. Who stood in the counsel of the Lord? Who has heard his thoughts? Who has actually stopped in all of the noise and asked God, what are you saying, God? What do you mean by this? I want to say something. He's calling a generation to listen. And when we learn to listen, we are going to learn to submit. And when we learn to submit, we're going to learn to grow up. We got to grow up. This is an hour where we're growing up. You guys, this is what's happening. We're in a crisis. A crisis consistently matures people. It's maturing of the church. We're at this hour. It's a good hour. But he's calling us to listen. The noise is everywhere. It's everywhere. And we're silent today, and we're declaring Palm Sunday, Jesus is King. But the first thing we need to understand is that the enemies of God are our enemies. And yes, there is a devil. I said this last week. But God will use agents of wrath to let the whirlwind go. He is in charge of the whirlwind. And if there's a whirlwind happening in the United States in one place, it's happening to all of us. We are a united place. If it's happening in Louisiana, it's happening in Kansas City. If it's happening in Kansas City, it's happening in New York. If it's happening in New York, it's happening in Minnesota, in Detroit, in California. The whirlwind has gone forth. We need to understand the enemies of God are our enemies, and we are to resist them. But he allows them to come forth. And when they come forth, we resist the powers of darkness. What are you trying to overcome? You resist it. God says, this is an hour you're going to learn to resist the enemy, and you're going to learn to submit to me in the process. There's a lot of people, it says, the whirlwind of the Lord falls violently. Is everybody that's getting hit with coronavirus a wicked? No. But do you know that in Zephaniah, God calls those who don't pray wicked? There's a different definition of wicked than what you think God says. There's a lot of understanding that needs to happen for the church to take this next step. We're going into a jump. We're going into something. There's a season ahead of us. It's going to be bad, but it could be really, really good. We can choose. We have the opportunity right now. I was talking to my friend Brittany earlier, and I was thinking the one thing that God is wanting the church to do is learn to submit. He wants us to repent. He wants us to learn to resist the devil, to resist the enemy, but he wants us to learn to cooperate, to submit to him. And I said to her, I was thinking, I always think of the movie Free Willy, where he's in the water and he's trying to get the whale out, and he says, hey Willie, I got you to the water, but you have to do the rest. You've got to learn to cooperate. There's a season. You cannot just be nominal Christians and go, this is all that God requires. I mean, it's not going to work. This is an hour where God's going, no, that is not what I'm looking for. I'm not looking for nominal Christians who say they like me on Sunday, but that it has no effect on their life. And so I'm going to shake everything in the judgments. I'm going to rattle your cage to make you ask me what I'm doing. I am judging the darkness. I am judging the places that are corrupt. I'm judging. I'm releasing justice so people can get saved. I'm releasing power across the earth. Everything is mine. And he said, this is a day that we're going to declare him king. But shh, there's a lot of noise. There's a lot of noise. I want to tell you, the places of noise is the news, the opinions of others. Facebook itself is filled with noise. Twitter is filled with noise. Places of social media, places are filled with noise. We get in conversations with one another, and it's filled with noise. And I think that God's saying, shh, are you getting your Bible out? Are you asking me what I'm saying? I want you to cooperate. It's very hard, but once you get that rhythm going, you can get that rhythm going. You can do it. You can do it. You can do it. I want to talk to those of you that are depressed, that are stuck in your house right now. There's a choice that you can make. There's a choice that you can make to reach to God. I know that it is hard. I know what we're going through is hard. I know some of you haven't been out of your house for a long time. I know there's struggles going on in marriages right now. We're stuck in a house and we don't know what to do. God is giving us choices right now in our personal animosities towards one another, in our personal animosities towards the nation, in our personal animosities towards our family members. God gives us a choice right now. There's a window, I believe, that's open that we would make amends, that we would learn, hey, I'm going to be the one that's responsible for me. I am. It's going to be my choice today to learn, to resist darkness, and to be kind. You know, it's going to be my choice today that I'm going to rise up and decide that depression is not going to have a hold on me. I'm going to resist it, and I'm going to stand up and say, God is king, and I'm going to be okay, and it is a good day because it's the day that the Lord has made. It says, let us be happy and be glad in it. Well, God, we're stuck here in our houses. I believe God wants us to learn to honor one another. This is a big deal. I believe that's the whole place that I want to talk about, is that place of honor and submitting. That's where we're at today. Whether you're trying to overcome or whether you're trying to protect yourself from the virus, or whether you're overcoming addictions, whether you're overcoming the depression, whether you're overcoming suicidal thoughts, where you're overcoming, I'm alone in my house. I don't know what to do. I'm going crazy. I want to give you hope. God is here with us. He is absolutely here with us. You know what? And if I don't get to this, I want to just say, mark your Bible, Psalm 25. Go find it today. God will hearken unto your voice. He will hear what you have to say. But then he's going to talk back. And some things he's going to say we might not like to hear, because the whirlwind has gone forth in fury. There is a place, a side that God has, and we do not like to address it. It's the severity of God. It's also the kindness of God. You say, Lisa, you make God out to be mad. No, there's a moment where God stands up and says, I've had enough. I've had enough. There's also very gracious Jesus who hung on the cross. That's the season we're in. He died so that we could find life and be reconciled to God. We declare him king, and then we turn our lives over to him. You say, no, I want this part. God goes, no, you give it to me. You give that part to me. No, I want this part. He says, no, you give it to me. You give that part to me. You submit to me all the way. There is something going on. No, God is not mad at you, but he's got some dealings he's making with the earth. He's got some dealings. If you can put your ear to the wall, if he was going to let you be a fly on the wall in some of these places, you would see he's dealing with some of the blood that has been poured out on the earth. He's dealing with some of the corruption. He's dealing with it, but we're all in it together. We're all in it together. You're not in it by yourself. I'm in it with you. We're in this thing together. I am God's favorite. I know you think you are, but I am God's favorite. And today I want you to say to you that you can be God's favorite too. It's an absolute mindset. It falls back on what I said last week. You know, we were in the middle of the crisis. I said, it's all about faith. Do you know, I just have to stop for a minute. Do you know that I declared last week in the middle of groaning to God over my grandbabies, who, by the way, they still need prayer. They need you to pray. They are not breathing, and they're changing the rules at those hospitals. And we do not want those babies to be in that hospital by themselves without their mother. The baby's father, Kevin, cannot go in. Only one can go in, and the mother has to go in and nurse. And so it's affecting everybody. We need to get the babies to breathe. But do you know, last week, it was such a hard week. But I went back and I thought about it, and I declared, I'm going to see a miracle today. I'm in the middle of a fast, and I didn't have a smile on my face. I have a smile on my face today because I watched with my eyes a miracle. I saw it. We have the TV screens. They have Angel Eye, and Ray's got it hooked up all over our house. We've gotten to know those babies with them being on TV. twice as good as we would if they were at home. Lots of people are watching the babies on Angel Eye. They're putting their finger on their little heads and praying for them. It is, you look at that and go, we're in the middle of a crisis. But God's given us a way to get to know the babies. How does that happen? But I declared, I'm going to see a miracle today. And I saw a miracle right before my eyes. They put that baby was on a respirator. And 2 or 3 hours after, we were so upset. It was a COVID-19. He was locked up. They had to suit up before they could even get in there. That's what the doctor was telling them. And one moment we were looking and they started sucking something out of that baby's mouth. It was the weirdest thing. And the whole thing went blank. And do you know, 30 minutes later, we thought that they came back on the TV screen and I saw the baby's dad looking right at the baby that was the sickest. And that baby had his eyes open for the first time. And the baby's father, Kevin, was staring right at that baby. That was the first thing I saw. That morning, though, I declared, we are gonna see, or the morning before, we are gonna see a miracle. And I want you that are depressed to stand up and say, I am gonna see a miracle. And then it takes faith. It takes a prevailing faith that you are gonna be okay. What is the breakthrough you're looking for? It doesn't even matter if you're on the fast with us. But some of you, you're on the fast. What is the breakthrough you're looking for? You get up and you start asking God for it. This is a time. I declare it. I'm going to be sane. I'm not going to be crazy. I'm not going to live under a shroud of death and darkness. I'm going to break free. I tell the girls at Hope City, you learn the self-talk. You learn to self-talk. You talk yourself out of. You could sit there and be depressed and moan and groan. Nobody likes me and I'm all alone. Or you could self-talk. I'm going to get up and I'm going to be okay. I'm going to call somebody up today and I'm going to cheer them up. I'm going to say something on Facebook that's relevant. I'm going to say something on Facebook that's helpful. I'm going to say something on Facebook that is worthy to hear. It is so hard to watch Facebook when there is nothing but complaining and griping. There is a struggle going on. People are actually dying. And it matters. And it matters that we pay attention. It matters to God that we would look at our brothers and sisters who are struggling right now and pay attention. You may never get it, but you may end up getting it. You may be asymptomatic where you carry it and you give it to people. 650 people died in New York yesterday from the COVID virus. You may say, well, 650 people got in a car wreck yesterday. You know what? We have had a lot of people die from this disease in a month, and it's climbing. And here in Missouri, the numbers are climbing and they're changing the law. But I want to talk this morning about what else is coming out of our mouths when we are in the season. So we're in a moment of silence. We're going to sit before God and ask him what he's going to say. We're looking at Psalm 25. We're looking at Jeremiah 23. Who has stood in the council? I want to stand in the council. I want to ask God what he's saying. But I also want to talk about this. When we have been placed by God himself in a season of captivity, you may think it's harsh. I believe it. I believe that the devil is God's devil and that he can do what he wants and that he raises up agents of wrath and that's what is happening. But once we're placed in the land of captivity, what are you going to do? I'm mouthy. I got to learn to keep my mouth. You mouthy? I know some of you are mouthy because I listen to you. I work with you. You mouthy? I'm going to learn to guard my mouth. I want to learn that my animosity is not helpful. It's not helpful in this hour. And God is wanting us to pull it in. I want to just say to you, what is coming out of your mouth? Because you want to avoid personal animosities. I said that earlier, but you want to avoid them. Mostly because of the chatter. That's all we're hearing. And so then we repeat it. And we're in a culture. We're in a culture full of fear. We're in a culture full of offense. We're in a culture full of lust. We're in a culture full of where we, you know, trade off each other. Where we throw people under the bus, where we put people out on blast. We're in that culture. And it's not a great thing to do when we're in the middle of God dealing with us. He's dealing with all of us. And I just want to talk about it. Lamentations 3:25. I'm going to read it to you. The Lord is good to those who wait for him. We can actually wait for God, and he's going to be good to us. You know what? He's going to be good to the Stribling family. He's going to be good to the Bickle family. He's going to be good to your family because we're waiting. I'm just telling you, there are lots of people asking me, what's going on, Lisa? What's God saying? And I'm like, hey, you know what? The Lord is talking to us, and he's going to be good to us, but he wants us to wait on him. Remember, I don't have a midnight hour right here to show you, but the midnight hour is on its way out with a lot of people. It's on its way out in shipping. It's coming to your house. People are getting it for free. They're asking us for it on pray@hopecity.com. And you can get that book sent to you for free. But the Lord is good to those who wait for him. Are you waiting on him? To the soul who seeks him. I want you to know, Jeremiah wrote this lamentation while they were in captivity. I want you to know that before we go any further. It is good that one should hope and wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord while the land's in captivity. This is a good thing. It says, let him sit alone and keep silent because God has laid it on him. God himself has laid this on us. I know, they say, no, it can't be. But it says right here, in Lamentations, in the day of Jeremiah, in that they were carried away into Babylon. You may not know the story. Go read it in 1st and 2nd Kings, and then go read Jeremiah and read Lamentations. It's one complete story. It's a story that's helpful for us right now. But he said, it is good because God has laid it on him. Let him put his mouth to the dust. Let him put his mouth down, that there yet may be hope. So God is actually saying, when you put your mouth to the dust and you wait on me, there may be hope. There yet may be hope. We don't know which way this thing's going to go. It could literally be laid to rest. God could put it under our feet. We're champions. He could put it under our feet. Some are hoping that it happens this week. I'm not saying that. I have no ability to say that. I am standing in God's counsel, though, and I am saying to you, God is going to send a revival to this nation. Just don't know when it's going to happen. We have looked for revival. We have prayed for revival. It's going to happen. But I'm telling you, I and a lot of others are waiting to hear what God says, and we're learning to submit our mouth. We're taking those personal animosities, and we're putting them to the side for the moment, and we're asking God, what are you doing? Because you yourself have laid it on me. There may be hope. It says, let him give his cheek to the one who strikes him and be full of reproach. It says, the Lord won't cast us off forever. Though he causes grief, yet he will show compassion according to the multitude of his mercies. He's very merciful. And he will show compassion to us. He does not afflict us willingly, nor does he grieve the children of men. It says he doesn't like to do it, but he says when he gets to the place where we're not listening, he's got to do it. He's got to do it. And the church has got to embrace the dust. And you know what? In Jeremiah's day, they were late in the game of embracing the dust, but embracing the dust was good. They put their mouths to the dust, and they embraced it, and God said that was a sign to him that he could release hope. And I'm saying that to you who that are stuck in your house and you're depressed. Where's the hope? God said in Lamentations in the hour that they're captive or in captivity. You know, everybody from Donald Trump down to the homeless man down into the West Bottoms of Kansas City is in captivity. Everybody. We're all in this together. There is nobody that can be set apart to say, this isn't going to affect me. We don't know. We put our mouth down and we say, it's you, God. You laid it on us. You want a response from America. You're looking for repentance in this hour for America. There is a message right now that says that you can get forgiveness by Jesus without repentance and change. Repentance means a turn. This is an hour. Resurrection powers. Easter. That's what it's about. Jesus resurrects. He does. It's not a bunny. It's not an Easter bunny moment. It's not about an Easter bunny. It's about Jesus resurrecting so he could give us the power. People, do you get what I'm saying? You look and you turn away, though. You look and you go, but I'm still stumbling. Jesus says, it's okay. We're all sinful. I'm going to take you there. But if you willfully look at me and say, God, not a chance, that's where it turns into he separates the men from the mice. I'm just saying, this is my opinion. They embraced the dust, but they were a little late in the game in doing it. Psalm 42. Hi, some of you guys that are just getting here. Hi, how you doing? I know some of you guys in Florida are watching us. I know some of you guys in Ohio are watching. I know some of you guys in California are watching. And then some of you are going to come in a little bit later because you're a couple hours behind. You're going to see us. Psalm 42 is one of our favorite psalms. It says, Jerusalem remembered in the days of her misery. This is in the days of their captivity. Let me say something to you. It says, they remembered their misery in their misery. They remembered the good days. You remember the good old days? It says they stopped and they remembered. In all their misery, they remembered the things that God had done for them. Are you grateful today? Are you grateful for the things that God has done for you? Are you complaining? Are you griping? Are you remembering? God, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, God. I'm asking you, God, to forgive me for not being grateful. God, I ask you to help us to be more grateful. I want to be grateful. I want to be thankful. They remembered God in their misery. In their misery, they remembered everything that God had done for them in the middle of their captivity. We're in a place of misery, and I want to ask you, are you in the? Can you place yourself in Psalm 42? Can you remember all the good things? Look at all the good things. Or are you complaining and lashing out at people? Forget it, you guys. Forget it. Doesn't matter who did it. Doesn't matter anymore who did it. Where did it come from? How did it happen? What are they saying? I mean, I know. I heard a story yesterday. I wanted to share it, but it was filled with bad language. But at the end of the day, it impacted me so greatly because I go into the prisons. And I was given a video of the prisons. And somebody had slipped a phone in. And some of you guys are seeing it. It's out there. It's on Twitter and Reddit and those different places. And this guy had gotten a phone in. And he was in a cell. And it was a very small cell. And he got a 10-minute video out. And both of his cellies had COVID-19. And one of them, you could hear, was dying. You could hear him dying in the background. And this dude's like, please help us. He said the nurse came through. They had a tent set up out on the yard for where they were placing people that were almost dying. And the nurse came through and he said, you guys need to be prepared. It is coming. And I think that they've released a Compassion Act where they're letting some of these people out of prison. But this guy was like, please help us. You know, we have to remember how grateful we are that we're able to not be stuck in some prison. There's 1.2 million people. I may be saying that wrong. Bill Quorum, you can correct me later. But there's a lot of people stuck in prison right now that are pounding on the door. Well, I'm going to say, pound on the door of heaven for them. If you have an inmate that you love, pound on heaven's door that Compassion Act can get to them. Some of them need to be let out. Some of them you don't want to be let out. Oh, I'm not going to go there too much farther, but that's the deal. They're dying right there too. They remembered what God had done for them, all the pleasant things that God had done in the days of old. And during the judgments, it said they laid their instruments, their things of celebration aside. They laid the party aside. America, I'm watching you party your brains out. You have not laid the party aside. You're using this as a party. Hey, go for it. Have a good time. But the Lord's saying, I want you to awaken to something else because there is something greater, something more dramatic, something more problematic for you. Have you ever been in a fight where it's a 1-2 punch? Have you ever had one punch and then you turn around and you get another one? Or you get one and you think that's it and then you get smacked again? God said, there yet may be hope according to what the earth does and how she responds. I'm telling you, you are not out of the woods. You're sitting there laughing, having a party. You are not out of the woods. You're not. This is a great time to get saved. I'm talking to you people who are unbelievers, some of you that are nominal Christians, some of you that are saying you're Christians and you're actually not. You need to get saved. You need to give your life to Jesus. They remembered. They were thankful and they were yet hopeful because God was going to hear them in their hour of captivity. In the very beginning of that captivity, this is what Jeremiah told the king that God said. God said this. And I wish you had the notes. I didn't send the notes out. And I usually do. But it says this. Jeremiah told the king, hey, dude, it doesn't have to go this way. You can submit to the judgments. I'm judging you. They were surrounded. Their nation was surrounded. They had a freeze on the food. They had surrounded them completely. And Jeremiah told that king, he said, hey, dude, it don't have to go this way. And the king would not submit because he had a crowd of people who didn't want to give up their power. So they talked him out of submitting. They said, don't listen to that prophet. I'm not calling myself a prophet. I'm just reading the Bible. Don't listen to that prophet. Don't do it. And so the king was conflicted. And he ended up going away from what God said. And it could have been completely different. Just imagine how many people are not listening. How many people are not listening. But then I want to say how many people are. And how many people are in a fast. And how many people are looking and taking the numbers. And taking everything seriously. And going, okay, 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 okay. I give. Here it is. I'm going to pray for you because you're not going to pray. I'm going to stand in the gap and pray. And hallelujah, we have this fast going. And it was not by accident. God designed it right in the middle of COVID-19. Do we submit? I want to give you another story of submitting. I want to talk for just 2 seconds about Saul and David. You guys know the story? Saul was king and he didn't please God. And so God went and found David. And he said David was a man after his own heart. You guys can read the story in 1 and 2 Samuel and 1 and 2 Kings. But right there, David enters into the story. He's just a young kid. And he's got the deal on him. Saul wasn't pleasing to God anymore. David was sinful. He had all kinds of problems. I want to say to some of you young people, David was anointed by God, but he was put on the run for 10 years. Listen, I'm anointed by God, we say. Oh, God goes, that is, if you're anointed by God, you are put in that cave and you are being made to mature. And if there is a revival coming, God has put America in a cave for a moment. And we are going to submit. If you think somehow you're anointed by God and you're going to be a big shot out on some stage and you're not going to go through the struggle, you're crazy. You have to go through the struggle to get to the place where God's going to mature you. And that's where we're at. This is bad. If you're in a hot spot zone, this is bad. If you're in a place where you're watching the numbers, we're in Missouri and we're watching 300, 400 a day, and you know they're only testing the ones that are really sick, really sick. And sometimes I pull away from the news because I can't take it, but I watch the personal stories and they break your heart. I watched the man. You guys see the same stories as I do because we're all bored. We're all inside the house unless we get to go to work. And we go to work for a few minutes and then we come back and we wash up and we hang out. But you're seeing the same stories I am. I want you to know God anointed David. He was a little kid and he had God's pleasure on him. And he had God's favor on him, but God took him and he put him in captivity. And he had to run from Saul for 10 years. But you know what his heart response was? Far be it from me to disregard or to talk or to come against negatively God's anointed, which was Saul in that hour. And I'm saying for everybody that's over you, or that's under you, the attitude that pleased God was that far be it from me to release vengeance out of my mouth against these people, because God says if I stand and put my mouth in the dust in this hour of captivity, here it is, God said vengeance is mine and I will repay. I'm in the land. You can see his big feet. He's walking down the streets. They're big feet, America. And he's coming through the land. And he's just saying, hey, for the church, right now is the time to keep your head low. Down, 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 down. And he goes, it brings me pleasure because your heart is after mine. And what I'm looking for, and what I'm looking for is submission and repentance all across the land. The big wigs all the way down to the little guy. It says that in 1 Samuel 18, it said this, David behaved more wisely than all of the others. This guy knew that he had the anointing on him, and he was put in positions, but it said he behaved wisely more than all the others. And you know what? It made Saul crazy because he couldn't find any accusation to bring against him. That's what God was looking for. The behavior, that we behave wisely. We train, this is a great opportunity to train your kids right now. Train your kids, train them, have devotionals, teach them to pray. Teach him those apostolic prayers that Mike Bickle gives us. My gosh, this man is wonderful. He's given us these prayers. Teach those little bitty kids to pray those prayers. Teach those kids. Right now is the time to honor. It says that kids are going to grow up and hate their parents and turn on one another. That's what it says. Before this thing's over, it'll get really ugly, but there's a side that is going to be really beautiful, and God's got this thing. You know, there's 20 stadium events in the United States in the stadiums planned for the church to come together and find God and anoint God king over America. That's really what this is about. It says, be silent because I am a great king and I am walking through the land and I am looking to and fro. I'm looking here and I'm looking there to see who's going to give their heart totally to me. And David, he behaved more wisely. Is the church playing a part in this? Is your depression bigger than God? I just feel that today, that was one of the things that we wanted to hit. Is your depression bigger than God, that he can't get you out of it? That you and him can't do some business right there? That you can't learn how to pray and bust out of it and get yourself together right there? Psalm 39, here's another place. This is in the Psalms. You guys, you love the Psalms. You say, God doesn't do that. Listen to what David said. I said, Psalm 39, verse 1 and 2. I said, I will guard my ways, lest I sin with my tongue. David, he prudently kept silent, even from speaking good sometimes, because he knew he threw his pearls before swine, before the wicked, and it would get him in trouble. He said, sometimes I even kept my mouth shut completely, and I had the answer. I'm the smart one, and I had the answer, and I kept my mouth shut. We keep our mouth shut sometimes, he said, but I guarded my mouth, lest my mouth sin, because I knew that God had laid it on me, especially in front of the unbeliever, especially in front of the wicked. They look at us and they go, well, the guys aren't any different than we are. That's because usually we're running our mouths. You know what? I know a whole lot of things, but I don't need to say them. I don't have to tell you what I know to make myself look big. Now's the time to get into the corner and look small. Hey, I like being the small one. I've been the last born all my life. Obviously, you're not going to jump positions. Well, actually, there's 7 in our family, and some of them have jumped positions. I have a sister that's now the big sister, and she jumped positioned when my other sister that we love dearly just passed away this last summer. So some of you get to jump positions, but I'm never going to jump position. And I have been the last born, and for the last 15 years, I will say this graciously with honor, but I'm also going to say it with a little tongue-in-cheek. I've been stuck in the inner city. You know what? I said, I'll submit to you, God. God goes, go to the inner city. I went to the east side. I love the east side. I love some of you on the east side, but I don't want to come to the east side. And you know what? The east side is the last place, the very, 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 very last place in Kansas City. And it's the last corner of this city. I would even almost say it's the last corner of the state. There's a few places, I'm sure, in East St. Louis that gives us a run for our money. But here it is. God says, even when you're in the last place and you feel like there's no hope, I'm never going to get out of this place. I'm always, they said to me, well, when you see one of your family members die, when you're the last born and you got a big family, you're going to watch them all die. I said, great, that's wonderful to hear. That's a great thing to hear. You know what? That's very sad. That's kind of like crazy. You want to embrace that place in your life. I embrace that place. When we went into Hope City, when we came into the inner city, we've been in the inner city 15 years, but we actually have been in the inner city about 25 years. We've actually been in the inner city about 40 years. You know what? We've lived there our whole lives. So, stuck. I said one time, I went out of here so bad. And I got to go for a while. But then the Lord said, it's time to go back. You can never, ever, 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 ever leave those fallen comrades. And we've got to lead tons of people to the Lord. And I want to lead you to the Lord today. I watched Ray lead somebody to the Lord that we used to do drugs with the other day. She would never be on here because she doesn't understand technology. But I watched Ray lead her to the Lord. We took her some food. And she was there. She lives right by Hope City. And she's like, what is going on with you two? You know what? And she offered us some dope. We're right there. And we're like, and there was a dope deal going on too. And me and Ray were staring, and the dope man's looking, and he's like, what we do? Who are these people? You know, they could tell that we were normal. And she's like, ah, don't worry about them. Here's what I want. And they did the dope deal. And she said, you guys want some? And we're like, no, we don't want no dope. No, we're here to bring Jesus. We're here to declare that you are going to die and go to hell because you are very sick if you don't take him in as your Lord and Savior. Well, we don't know if it really, it's not funny. But when we walked out, we're like, did that work? Was that like, what was that? That was crazy. Because Ray said, you're going to get saved today. I don't care if I have to drag you out of here by your hair. Today's the day of salvation for your household. And we've got our eye on her. And we're going in and out of our house. But back to the story. When bad things happen to us, far be it from us to be the one that takes vengeance. Let the Lord do his work in the United States. And leave some of these people alone. There are plenty of people in politics we don't like. You think you're on one side and you're the only guy that doesn't like anybody. Well, guess what? There's people all on the other side and they don't like that other half people. Who cares? It doesn't matter. They're in the deal with us. Do you think that they're out of this deal? No. You're seeing the struggle right there. They're in the deal with us. I don't want to badmouth some of these people I don't like. You say, when the church says, Donald Trump is the man for the hour, you immediately hear the church say, God says he's awesome. That is not what the church is saying. There is an appointed moment. Barack Obama was appointed by God. It says in Isaiah 45, verse 1, that Cyrus was appointed by God as an agent of wrath to set Israel free. He did not say, you are a wonderful, great guy. He said that about David, though. He said, David's a guy after my own heart. This is how David behaved. This is what David did. And it took a long time to get there. But he doesn't say that about everybody. And so when you hear the church say, Donald Trump has been appointed, you go, oh, I hate the church. That's not what the church is saying. They understand the text that God appoints people. And sometimes those people are agents of wrath. Well, if you're on the other side of the aisle, like some of us are, you go, how dare you say that Donald Trump is an agent of wrath? You say it to me because I don't like him. And all the other people are getting off the hook. Well, you know what? Barack Obama was an agent of wrath too. For the other side, they loved him. And then there was a side that didn't like him. But he was appointed to allow us to have whatever we wanted. Romans 1 said, you get whatever you want, and then that thing's going to turn on you. He was appointed as well. America, we're in a time of captivity. Quit worrying about who's doing what and figure out where your own life is. Where are your children going? Where are they going? Where are your 17-year-olds going? Do you have 17-year-olds that could be produced like David that can go into the wilderness? I'm afraid. I've got 13 grandchildren right now. I'm looking at my grandsons and I'm going, they're growing. I've got one more on the way. She's going to be a girl. But these boys, I just had 3 baby infant boys that are growing. This crowd's growing. And I'm looking and I'm going, do my kids have what it takes to produce Davids? Do they have what it takes to produce what it's going to take to get us through? Are we sitting around in our house teaching our kids how to gripe, how to moan? If we constantly pray that one side falls, if we constantly pray that our adversary falls, don't think for a moment that we're going to get off the hook. if one side falls, we all fall. It's just the way it is. Revelation 18 says, render to her, just as she rendered to you, and repay her double according to her works. Everything is being watched by God at this moment. I want to submit to God, and I want you to submit to God. It is an hour for repentance. We shouldn't expect to find mercy anywhere if we are not able to give it, if we are not even willing to give it, even if we give it and then we take it back and we stumble and we go, okay, I'm going to give it again. We have to give it. You've got to give it. If you don't give it, you're not going to get it. Vengeance is mine, God says. But if you think one side's worse than you are, or if you think one side's more responsible for the mess that America's in, I'm as responsible as you are. You're as responsible as they are. Quit pointing the fingers. That's what I want to say. You know what? We should expect to find mercy and hope, though, if we look at God and go, I submit. That's what I want to do right now. I want to pray for you that you would submit. What are the things that you're struggling with? What are the things that you're resisting? I want us to learn to pray. You resist that devil. You resist it. It's okay. God's got it under control. You get confused. You go, I don't understand what you're saying. Just look at it this way. God releases agents of wrath to produce salvation. It's like when you were told to go to your bedroom when you were a little kid. The reason was so you could think about what you did. So you go into your bedroom and you think about it. Or when you got a whooping. I don't know. Some of you got a whooping. I don't know. I was kind of bratty. I didn't have any parents, really. I was pretty spoiled. But I do remember a whipping or two. And I do remember a backhand or two. But you were put in your room. That's what an agent of wrath does. He puts you in your room, regardless if it's the devil or not. It is discipline, first for the church and then for everybody else. So you're looking and going, the church. No, the church is in the deal. God is scourging the land. He's putting us in our bedrooms, and he's telling us to think about what you've done. There's blood that has to be accounted for in this land. I will not stop saying that. There are 60-plus million babies in this soil that we have to think about. I don't want to get all political. There's murder a day, one a day. There's 20,000 homicides in the United States of America, one a day in Kansas City. Blood's everywhere. And we're responsible. And we can get mercy, but we have to ask God to come into our lives and help us to change, to give up some of those things that we're holding. And so right now, we're going to end with me praying for you. I want to pray for you. I want to particularly call out depression. I want to say to those of you that are depressed, there's hope. This isn't going to last forever. It says in Lamentations, when you're in that captivity, yet there is hope, because we put our mouths to the dust. When you're yelling and you're hollering and you're crying out and you say, I want out of this room, I want out, God says, I'm going to let you out of your bedroom, but you're going to acknowledge what you've done. You stand in front of your parents and you honor them. You stand in front of God and you honor him. You stand in front of America and you say, God, I'm thankful for the country and the nation. I'm thankful. God, I ask you right now that you would help. If you're not saved, I want to pray for you. Lord, I ask you to come into my heart. I ask you, it's a simple prayer. I ask you to come into my life. I know that I talk about you, but I haven't fully submitted to you. All those prodigals, we ask you to come home right now. God is here to receive those who have used the name of Jesus but has not turned their lives over. God, I ask you to help them today. God, I turn my life over to you. And I ask that you would help me. I ask that you would help me deal with the things that I'm struggling with. I ask that you'd help me to overcome. I ask you to help me to put my mouth to the dust. In Jesus' name, I pray for all of us today. I ask you right now to ask God, what is it that you need to overcome? What is it in the places where we have spoken wrongly, or that we have refused to be grateful, or that we have refused to trust God, or that we have refused to acknowledge Him in this crisis in America? I ask God that you would touch us, that you would open us up, that you would awaken America now to the crisis that we're in and to the crisis that is yet coming. There is yet more to come. The Bible is clear. There is yet more to come. Revelation 6 says, people, there is more to come, and that you would awaken us. God, I ask you that you would awaken the church, and that for those who have no peace, that they would find peace. That those that are lonely, you would touch. For those that are suicidal, you would deliver. God, right now, all over the United States, I pray for those. God, I pray for those in Ohio. I pray for those in Detroit. I pray for those in Florida, God, that are filled with anxiety. God, I pray for those in New York right now that are stuck right now in their houses, in their apartments. The power of suicide, you would teach them to pray. Resist the powers of darkness and ask God to come and help you to overcome. We are going to get through this, but we need to mature. You would help us mature in these ways, God. Just a second. I'm talking to you, the one that needs to overcome depression and suicidal thoughts. I'm talking to you right now. I'm just asking the Holy Spirit to be released on those that are seriously depressed. God sees you. There's yet hope. I pray for you today, and I'm going to continue to pray for you. And you can send your prayers to pray@hopecitykc.com. And we'll pray for you, and we'll keep praying for you. And our prayer room is going to pray for you. And we'll see you guys next week. Amen.